there. Thank you all. Wow, what an introduction. Thanks. Before I start, I'm curious, is anybody tweeting now? Okay, a few. Very good. On Twitter, for those of you. Is okay. How many of you posted on Facebook that you're here now? A few of you. Okay, just curious. How many of you have an avatar? All right. Now all of you know what an avatar is, right? After the big movie? I mean, I used to. A month ago, 2 months ago, say, who has an avatar? I'm going to say, what's an avatar? Well, now everybody knows, so I'm very happy about that. These are avatars right here. And actually what you see is, here's my avatar, Corinda Rode, and she is on the Stockholm School of Economics Island in Second Life. Right now, there are a group of my students here chatting away because I've given them an exercise, and these students are from all over the world, but they are participants in the Masters of Marketing and Media Management program at our school and also at the Royal Institute of Technology. And I teach strategy, and for me, strategy is all about creating competitive advantage for firms, right? How do you win, and how do you get customers? How do you keep them, creating the sustainable competitive advantage? Well, this is where technology has really come in the recent years, really enabling firms to create competitive advantage, and I'll get back to that. So what I do in my courses is I very much use different forms of technology as different communication channels within the course, so I embed it. So last Friday, we actually had a presentation on Second Life for 2 hours where I showed them how to download it, install it on their computers, create an avatar, how to move around and so on, how to chat, how to talk, how to show presentations and so on. We visited a few different places. And so I gave them an assignment. And their assignment is to locate an avapreneur, which is what I call an entrepreneur in a virtual world, an avapreneur, coming from avatar and entrepreneur. Locate an avapreneur in a few different industries that I gave them and conduct an interview and find out all about this person and why this person is in Second Life creating a business. And so that right now they're actually chatting away and learning about what they should do and where should they go. So I'm going to get back to Second Life because I go over to my presentation now, which will get on the through the program, I guess, or through the conference webpage or something. But I can also say that I put all of my slideshows up on slideshare.net, and they're all downloadable in their original format, PowerPoint. So feel free to download whatever you want and use it as you wish if you find something of interest. I also lecture on social media, a few different networks, and so on. So there's a lot of stuff there. So again, please feel free to download it. What am I going to talk about today? Introductions and facts and figures about virtual worlds. How many of you are very familiar with virtual worlds? Okay, a few. So most of you, okay, so this is good. Oh, I thought I'd turn that off. Sorry. I guess I've got it. Sorry, I did turn that off. For some reason, it didn't. Sorry about that. Anyway, so we'll talk about virtual worlds, and then we'll look at education collaboration. And there's a book that's just come out by Tony O'Driscoll, professor at Duke University. Have any of you heard of this book, or maybe of Tony? His book is called Learning in 3D. And I have a few slides in my presentation from his book. But it's a very, very good book. It gives a lot of good examples for organizations and universities, companies, et cetera, who are interested in learning or using virtual worlds. Oh, sorry. I don't know what is going on here. I'm just going to turn this off. I don't know what happened. Sorry about that. Come on. So, I'd like to start out with background. Why is this interest in social networks, social media, virtual worlds, and so on? I put this very much into perspective. If we think about trends in history, there's a very famous researcher in Lund, Leonard Huen, who talks about, he's an economic historian, he says, well, you know, this financial crisis we're coming out of is quite predictable. If you look at trends over history and time, you see that there's been major innovations that have been followed by industrial revolutions, 30 to 40 years afterwards, after this innovation. What's not important is the innovation, but the actual diffusion of the innovation. That's when you get the social innovation. So what was happening here? Here is very much people left the countryside, right? Started moving into towns, working in firms, companies, manufacturing, and so on. Here, late 19th century, here you actually have the rise of the multinational firm, the multi-unit firm, these large multinational corporations. The question is, if we are entering the third industrial revolution, what will this new organizational form be? This is why I bring in my aspect in terms of strategy. Because what is firms and strategies all about? It's about creating value. Companies create value, don't they? And if we think about through time, what we've seen is you have physical capital, right, and you have human capital that go into making, creating value in a good or a service. Now, originally, if you think or way back, you saw very much this level of physical capital, or I'm sorry, of human capital was very high. So very high human capital. Over time, what we're seeing with these innovations leading to very much the physical capital taking over, creating more and more percent of the value added that the company creates. But what's happening now as we go into microelectronics and microprocessors? How old's the internet? The internet is also 40 years old, just turned 40 in October. What is happening? What is this going to be, this new organizational form, and where is value coming from? Well, if we think about previously, it's very much value is created within the boundaries of the firm, right? You have a firm. What is a firm? People employed by the firm, working for the firm, creating value for the firm. But through the internet, through what we're seeing, microelectronics, microprocessors, we're seeing more and more value being created outside the boundaries of the firm. So the question is, what will be these new organizational forms? How will social media, how will such things as the immersive internet, 3D internet, change the way that we create value in firms? And I think that's where it's a fascinating time to be studying and researching virtual worlds, because you're seeing all kinds of boundaries being erased. And that's what I talk a little bit about today, as well as the learning. How many of you have seen this film? Did you know Shift Happens? A few of you? I'll just show it. It's about 4 minutes long. Just kind of puts things into perspective, I think. Let's see if I can get this. Oh, there we go. See if I can get rid of this ad. There we go. And I have the sound on, so. But do you have the sound on? Because it's not coming. I have full sound. Yeah, it's coming. I can barely hear it though. There we go. Maybe you can turn up a little bit. Yeah. instructions. What does it all mean? What does it all mean? What does it mean when you see this? Thinking about you working in this, I mean, learning and learning technologies. What does all this mean? See, I like to, your name is Phil. Big heads, yeah, very big heads. Yeah, but I mean, it's amazing the amount of knowledge or information that's out there. How do we make sense of all of that that's out there? Any other reflections? Yeah, all learning is live. How do you mean? What do you mean by that? Yeah, constantly changing. If you think about the rapid pace of new technologies, new knowledge out there, I mean, if working in organizations. You don't have to remember everything, but actually, yeah.
It's crazy. So yeah. We teach children in school.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, but I think this is one of the things. It seems like education, we're lagging behind. I have some pictures of here. It's actually quite interesting. So much has changed out there in how we work, and actually how the younger generation is very much learning and collaborating through social media, but yet what's happening in education, for example? We are very far behind in that sense. I started out showing you that slide where it was talking about the Industrial Revolution, 30 to 40 years. What happens in the course of 30 to 40 years? Any guesses? Think about it. It's a whole new generation entering the workforce. And that's why what we're seeing, what one of the reasons that you see industrial revolutions, this new generation enters the workforce, is not bound by previous ways of thinking in terms of how to organize, how to collaborate, how to learn, what power is, what leadership is, and so on. They come along with a whole different set of way of thinking about it. And what we're seeing here, especially the younger, very younger, like the 9 to 12-year-olds, very active in Club Penguin and these other virtual worlds, what will it look like? What will the workforce look like in 10 or 15, 20 years when they're entering the workforce? What demands will they have? And I think that's really an exciting thing we're seeing. We haven't seen anything yet when it comes to the internet and what we can do. This I took from Tony O'Driscoll in his book. He talks very much, if you think about the way it's developed, Web 1.0, that was just connecting to, right? You connect to the internet. Web 2.0, now we're actually being able to connect through to or to other people through the internet, right? You're tweeting to others, you're posting on Facebook, etc., very much able to connect through. But what about this immersive internet? Now it's really about connecting within. And that's the exciting part, being able to connect within. Have any of you heard of the research that's being done at Stanford University? Brain research, where they're showing that actually people are, you know, if you see your avatar, for example, running, you think, your body actually thinks that you're in this world running. For example, so your pulse increases. So your physical mind is identifying with your avatar that it sees in these worlds. So for example, within healthcare, for example, people are perhaps overweight or need to be more fit. They'll give them a nice, slim, lean, well-trained avatar. And they're seeing that people are then becoming more like their avatar. So as a way of, you know, we're all still very much in the beginning. We don't understand the implications of seeing ourselves being within and what will happen when we even really become much more immersed. There's even discussions about, brain implants and all kinds of crazy things that are being researched right now. Tony O'Driscoll also said, you know, eBay allowed people to sell their personal items in a worldwide yard sale. The internet will allow them to sell their skills and abilities, right? Worldwide, anywhere. This is why I talk about micro-labor, micro-employees, the ability, the mobility of labor through these virtual worlds. And I'll show you some examples of this. So what are virtual worlds? Well, I showed you one. This is actually the same scene that you just saw live a couple minutes ago. But this is the way I like to think of them. They're persistent, right? So even if I log off, that world is still there. People can still visit it. I log off there. The students are still there. It's immersive. So exactly as I say, you immerse yourself in this environment. You identify with your avatar that you see in this world. And also research has shown that you tend to remember things much better when you actually are immersed. Think about you have a webinar, some type of conference, right, call. How much do you really remember from that conference call? But when you're actually in this environment, communicating with another, seeing things, experiencing things, this you remember much better. So in terms about learning, the ability to remember actually and experience something, learning by doing, is much more powerful here. Shared space, co-presence. You do things together with others. You communicate, you collaborate, you can build, etc., with others. You have tremendous possibilities of socialization, community. Some cases, ability to manipulate and create content, such as in Second Life, right? They create a platform. It's for the users to create your own content. So everything you see here was actually designed and built by, at the time, he was a doctoral student, a good colleague of mine, Göran Lindqvist. He built our whole island within 2 weeks over his Christmas break. And he did a very nice job. And in some cases, a virtual economy and currency. And this is quite interesting. What's going on in these virtual economies? You have virtual worlds that have a GDP that are higher than some of countries, national nations in the world now. And I'll show you some examples of these. So the way you think about it, this is often what we think about World of Warcraft, right? MMOs, these massively multiplayer online role-playing games. They have virtual worlds. Virtual worlds, I see these as different, right? You have these games and so on. Actually, a lot of researchers in strategy are now looking and researching guilds within World of Warcraft to understand decision-making, collaboration, and strategizing within these worlds. But here I think it's, you go into World of Warcraft, there is a quest, it's more of entertainment, it's a game, you have goals. You know, you find much of the younger generation goes into some of virtual worlds, such as Second Life. Well, what do I do now? It's just like going to Amsterdam or Paris if you don't know where to go or what to do. How do you know what to do? It's about finding your community and so on. Just to give you some facts, if anybody's interested, there's a nice site, K0, from England, not from the UK. And they have lots of data and facts, for example, in all the different virtual worlds that are out there. This shows you, for example, how many different ones they are. So all the red dots are actually, all the dots are virtual worlds. The red are live or open beta. The orange dots show when it was launched and where it is now. So here you can see a tremendous amount. This is ages. So here you have 8 to 10, 10 to 12, 13, and so on. Tremendous amount of virtual worlds by this younger generation. So the thing is, when these people start entering the workforce, perfectly accustomed, comfortable with collaborating with people across the world through these virtual worlds. Does anybody know what this is? This is a guild in World of Warcraft. And a guild is a group of people, it's about 30, and they're fighting this monster. So they have this task to kill this monster. Did you know that in Europe, to be one of the top guild, if you're one of the top guild leaders, you have serious recruiting programs to recruit people to be in your guild. It is very difficult to get into these guilds. It is a major task to actually get in. One of my students in my class, he took a leave of absence for 4 years from his job, or 4 months from his job, to actually play in one of these guilds. And now what you're seeing is that people are starting to put this on their CV. I'm a guild leader. But look at these qualifications. This is exactly the type of skills you want in your employees that are in an organization, right? Leading a virtual team of 30 individuals from across the globe. Yes, that's what they do, from all cultures, from all ages. All boundaries, cultural boundaries, demographic boundaries are overcome. Creating, successfully executing strategies under pressure. That's what they're doing. They have to kill that monster really fast. If you're a guild leader, what are you doing? You're communicating. You're organizing your group of people. You have emerged as a natural leader. Nobody has said you are going to be a guild leader, you know, given you that power. You have to earn that power. So you earn the right as a leader of this guild. You then coordinate these people through voice and through chat. They're all over the world. And you manage this cross-cultural conflict. We all know that creates quite a bit of difficulty. Diversity, the higher the diversity, the more likelihood that there is conflict. Right? But they do it all without face-to-face communication. They build trust. They create relationships, etc. So this you're beginning to see already people putting this on their CV. So think back where we were just 15 years ago with the internet. And you saw in the film, 1992 was the first SMS. We can't even imagine kind of now living without SMS. Where will we be in 15 years with the 3D internet? The things are going very quickly here. Here's a quotation by a professor in the US. He says, clearly if social activity migrates to synthetic worlds, economic activity will go there as well. And that's what we're really beginning to see. Here, many people say, yeah, Second Life, that's old news, right? That was really hip a few years ago, but it's so dead now. You know, there's nothing happening there. Yeah, but that's true. If you think about visibility in the media, this is called Gartner's hype cycle, you know, from Gartner Group. They say, yeah, new technologies, there's some technology. You can even think about it with the internet. You know, a lot of interest. Everybody runs after it. And that's what we saw about 3 years ago, right? Organizations running out there, putting out their, opening up their their shops and their stores and Second Life. And then, wait, well, where are the customers? And then pulling out, saying, this is crap. This is what, you know, we don't need to be here. So you kind of end up in this trough of disillusionment. But we're seeing very much that those who are there are very much very serious and really doing things and seeing, wow, look at the possibilities that we have here. I just was in the United States a few weeks ago at the National Science Foundation reviewing proposals That's the big funding agency in the U.S. that funds research. And so many of the projects that were coming in all relate to virtual worlds. A lot of interest, in all types of dimensions. So you can say, well, what financial crisis? In the physical world, yeah, we're all experiencing this financial crisis. No financial crisis here. Yeah, the economy's slowed down a bit. But new number of companies, increasing turnover by quite a bit, increasing members and so on. You're seeing really quite a lot happening here. If you think back in time, 2007, there was practically no virtual revenues, but now, extremely, a lot more. And you're saying, $3 billion, I've even seen up to $19 billion. Did anybody hear about this? January 10th or 11th? It was a space resort. Okay, space resort in Entropy Universe. It was orbiting planet Calypso. It was sold for $330,000. Somebody bought this space resort for $330,000. I mean, this is real dollars that they spent on this. Why would you do that? Well, somebody previously bought another space resort, and within 9 months, he paid, at that time it was the big record, it was $150,000. He made that money back within 9 months, and even more. So people are in these worlds actively spending money. So there's a whole new economy rising up here. And actually, I just received a large grant from the Nordic Innovation Center to do a project looking at entrepreneurship and innovation in virtual worlds, trying to figure out what is going on here. So if anybody's interested, you let me know, and I can give you more information on that. This is Entropia. Not only do they have this $420 million turnover in 2008, actually, it's a lot more in 2009. I don't have the figure yet. But they received a bank license from the government. So they are a real bank now, just like any bank in the world, where people deposit their money, they can get interest on it, they can borrow money. This is what you're seeing. You started out saying, virtual learning, real learning. Where's the boundary between virtual and real? A little bit of Second Life. Economy grew by 94% from 2008 to 2009. There are a lot of people out there already making some profit. Granted, it's not that much, but still, people are making profit. So a lot of activity is moving into world. Here's just some example if anybody's interested. All different types of things. These I took about more in terms of learning. Here's some different examples. So if you go into Second Life and you're interested in exploring, you can download Second Life for free. You can create an avatar for free. Then you can go and find. You can just search within Second Life, Boyington Airfield, UC Davis, and so on. All these different things you can do there. Experience schizophrenia, for example. You can actually go into building and experience what it's like to have schizophrenia. So you can actually create these simulations and environments which you can't do in the physical world. So a lot of potential there. I'll get back to some more in terms of the learning. Two big millionaires. They made lots of money in these worlds. Here's a store. You can walk in, sell things, buy things, etc., and make a lot of money. IBM selling products. Showcasing products. And here, I was at an information session by Unilever. They have people working across the world, right, with different products. So they have brought in all their product managers for Dove, the shampoo and soap. And so they created, everyone got an avatar, and they created a virtual space in Second Life for these avatars to meet from across the world. And the idea is that whenever there was a new product launch, you could launch it within Second Life. And you did not have to bring people from all over the world to actually come to this product launch. You could do it virtually. They also created a little cafe, and the idea is to create knowledge accidents, as we say. In the physical world, when you're at work, you walk down the hallway, you stop at the coffee machine or the printer or so on, you bump into somebody, and you start just chatting. It's the informal learning and social networking there that's going on. The idea here was to create a virtual cafe where people could then they'd be logged on in Paris, so you're sitting in Paris and you're in Tokyo, and you just sit at the table, and wow, you can start a conversation through your virtual cafe. So it's a way of creating this possibility to share knowledge across geographical boundaries. I'm going to show you this example. This is what I've been working a lot with Duke Corporate Education, Duke CE, a good friend of mine, Steve Mahaley, who actually I've never met. We've only worked together through Second Life. Our avatars have met, but we have never met. We created a training exercise, and the idea was, you work with multinational organizations. There are a lot of virtual teams, but working on virtual teams is very difficult, challenging. due to different languages, different time zones, due to being not physically present with one another, a lot of different things going on. So he said, well, how could we try to, you know, facilitate multinationals and improving virtual teaming skills within organizations? So we created a very simple exercise, and I'll show that to you now. So this we did on our island in Second Life. And it took some time to build, but not so bad. We did this. I actually have some information on this.
Welcome to 3D teaming in the virtual world of Second Life.
Actually, I'm going to talk over him instead. So now what you see is the different. This was with IBM. So we had, I think it was about 20 different people from IBM offices across the world, all different skill levels. We invited them. They came to an information session here first, where this is Steve Mahaley presenting. We go through what exactly we're going to be doing during this session. The whole thing, we had three different phases. The first phase was where they very much learned about Second Life and so on. This was done before the actual teaming event. Then when we had the teaming event, it lasted about 90 minutes. And the idea was we divided them up into four different teams. So they were geographically distributed, and they were each of them, we put them on their teams. And the idea was that they were to build a bridge together in Second Life. We went through, we had given them literature prior to the actual exercise on virtual teaming. And we actually told them, too, about how to manipulate things in Second Life. So then in this event, they were to build a bridge from the actual, from the bay, across the bay, so from the land to the pier there. So here you can see some of the members talking, chatting. And the idea is that in this little canister, there are different parts. So they have to pull out parts from this canister, get notes. And then they find different pieces in their inventories. So it's quite easy to actually pull out pieces, move them around, and build this bridge. So as you can see, they're starting to build now. There's some piece out there. They've pulled out pieces over there. The interesting thing was that even though we had given them some literature which they'd read, we had talked about them, presented the things on virtual teaming skills, they still more or less forgot everything once they got in there when they were building the bridge. Assumptions, for example, uncovering assumptions. They didn't say, well, what is a bridge? No one discussed that. Communicate. Some people were extremely silent. And we said, so it was quite interesting here seeing, challenging them to actually learn some of these skills. They did not really realize that until they were in there. So we had coaches saying, well, why aren't you communicating more now? What is your assumption about the bridge and so on? Actually, we did this after they were working for a while. So there you can actually see they ended up building the bridge across. Once that was done, we had a debriefing session. Just to give one funny example, there was one group saying, they were saying, oh, come on, there was one who emerged as a natural leader, and she was trying to get the others to participate, to help build this bridge. And the person said, was being very quiet. She said, come on, if anybody has anything to say, please jump in. Well, so what does one of the avatars do? They go and they run and they jump in the water. So it's completely not at all what she, So there was a very good example of this, cross-cultural communication that is very quite difficult. So this was just one example that we've done, and we've done it with Sun Microsystems and IBM, and we're talking with a few other organizations right now. It was a very simple example that we developed, which actually taking, what you can do, you can't do this in the physical world, building a bridge, it's very difficult. You can build other things, tinker toys and so on, but here you can actually build a bridge in a sense. The question we said, well, what about building a bridge? Why did you put pylons, or these, the pillars that it stands on? Why did you all put pylons there? We did not say you had to put pylons. We just said build a bridge. So this also is talking about what assumptions. Everyone came in with an assumption that a bridge has pylons. But we did not say it. All you had to do was walk across the bridge from the bay or from the sand to the pier without falling in. So this is, again, is a way of revealing, say, these assumptions that we take with us. So that's just one example training and within Second Life. If anybody is interested in learning more about that, let me know. And I can take you and show you on the island, and we can talk more about that. So that was one example. Other examples, you can talk about finding and recruiting. Amazon is already recruiting in Second Life. Many other organizations are doing that as well, IBM, Accenture, and so on. Think about it, the ability to reach out and meet potential recruits from across the world cheaply. You set up your little booth or even college fairs now. where you can go and recruit. So it's a very easy way of reaching out to people across the world. So I talk about this, from the mobility of goods, that's what we've seen quite a lot, and if we think about through history, we've had the mobility of goods, physical goods, to the mobility of financial capital, and the question is, here's Intel's office, to the mobility of labor. So now, as an employee, you can employ people from across the world quite easily, very cheaply. I know a person at IBM, he works 4 out of his 5 days a week in his Second Life office. So he actually works at his home, but yet he meets his colleagues, he meets his customers, partners, and so on, in the office, in Second Life. The future of 3D internet. Before the first plate of aluminum is ever bent for production, the passengers will have sat in the plane, crew will have serviced, and the pilots will have flown the plane. More and more is going in-world. In fact, the fashion industry has already moved quite a bit into these virtual worlds, as we're seeing architecture. And I think the question becomes, which professions and industries will not be revolutionized? A lot of change is going on here. This is very much kind of an overview of the virtual world's facts and figures. Spend the next half hour on looking at education and collaboration in these virtual worlds. And we think about it, there's a wide range of education. If you go into this wiki, for example, the Second Life wiki, you can find a tremendous number of organizations that are actually already there. How many of you are working with organizations that are in Second Life now? Or with any other virtual world? What are you doing there? What's your organization in? I'm sorry, Invest in Nottingham. The University of Nottingham. Okay, and what are you doing there?
I'm not for the university, but they have their campus.
Yes,
online.
The campus online. And do they have different courses, or what are they?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
I just know that you can do it.
Okay, so you can go through the campus. And you? Okay, EMC, a marketing building. What do you mean by a marketing building?
Just advertising.
Okay, advertising. Is anybody actively using Second Life in any other, or any other virtual? Yeah. You're one of the Twitters, right? Yeah, okay. What are you doing? I'm sorry, you're from?
Open,
you guys are really active. Yeah, I know all about you. Yeah, you're doing a lot out there, huh? Can you give some examples of what you're doing? Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Role play. Excellent example. Role play. I mean, think about the possibilities of doing role play in here. In fact, I know some people who actually hire actors within Second Life because you can hire actors for very cheaply, who can then play different roles. So say, you know, if you have if you're training a sales force or a doctor or something, you can actually have people play that role of the patient or a potential customer, and you can hire these people from across the world for very cheaply. So it's actually a fantastic way of using, of training as well, in terms of role playing. So all types of institutions and organizations are moving in world. And in fact, the University of Texas, for example, had a big launch, big rollout. So they've made pushes there. And I just saw this article in the Christian Science Monitor paper in the U.S. Actually, they don't even have a physical paper anymore. They're completely virtual now, this newspaper. But they said, you know, the future of college may be virtual. Is this the last generation to actually attend college physically? What do you think? Is it? There is a study that was done by the Department of Education, a commissioned study by the Department of Education in the U.S., that found that online learning, it was a study over the period of 10 years, found that online education provided better results than face-to-face in terms of the learning outcomes. It's cited in this article. But I don't know, what happens with the social side, the community side of actually the physical meeting? I don't know, so this will be, this is again, you know, we don't know where we're going. There's so many possibilities. Oh, sorry, I went the wrong way. So this is very much, I think, here. This is the way I think about learning. This is, you know, if you think about two dimensions, you have the participant reach. So you're talking about for people across the world, you can reach across the world. So very much the ability to reach far away. You know, you have co-located in the classroom, but you also have this degree of co-creation. I think that's where we've been very much talking heads, right, and in education and training. Very much talking heads, very much little doing. And I think this is where, how can you get in and actually co-create together with with your employees or with your students and so on. This is actually, we're doing a live case, which we say MBA Live, when we had our MBA program, where we work together with the CEOs and top management of large organizations on live strategic issues that they had. So the question is, where distributed in high degree of co-creation, what will this look like? And this is where virtual worlds are very much helping out. Here's Etienne Wenger. Have any of you heard of Etienne Wenger? No one. Okay, he wrote a book on communities of practice. But he went into organizations and said, where does learning occur? And where does work get done? And saw very much that it's about 70-80% of work and learning gets done through the informal networks. It's not through the formal, necessarily, education. It's not through the formal hierarchy, but it's very much through our peers, through our communities, those who very much share the same passion of what we're interested in doing, those we see as as groups of people who share a concern or a passion for something they do, and they learn how to do it better as they interact regularly. Very much this interaction is very important. You have a joint enterprise. You're working on things together. So he said, this is where learning happens. So how can we facilitate this learning? And this is where virtual worlds do enable this. But if we look way back when, this was a classroom from I think it was like the 1400s or 1500s, I mean, way back when. And I said, it can't be that long, sorry, they're not dressed that way. It was, sorry, I had some other ones, pictures previously that I took away. But when is this? This must be 200 years ago or so. Here they are sitting, it looks very much like today's classrooms, doesn't it? Not much difference. And if we think about that, he says, mind the trap. It was 1600. 1600, 1940, 1990, and then what are you seeing these universities doing, going in world and building the same type of classroom? This is where we get so stuck in our mind frame, right, our mindset. And this is why I was talking about the third, the Industrial Revolution taking 30 to 40 years. We're very stuck in our way of learning. This is the way it should occur. But we don't even understand really what the possibilities are of virtual worlds. We get stuck. So somehow we have to start trying to break out of this. And that's where it's important to experiment in all different ways of doing this. Alvin Toffler said, now that we are moving from factory work to anytime, anyplace work, we need an anytime, anyplace educational parallel. So that's what we're very much seeing with all the online education and so on, that students would much rather prefer to decide themselves. They have control over their own education. If you think about just in the music industry, going from being able to download the songs that you want and listen to them when you want. So he talks about, Tony Driscoll talks very much, escaping flat band, going from very much this 2D synchronous learning to this, wonderful 3D learning environment where you create these immersive areas where you can actually go in, as I was showing. So here he has some different examples in his book, and I'll talk about some of them as well as some others. This is one of the ones that I showed you from ours, our 3D global team experience. So very much how can you teach teaming skills, virtual teaming skills in a virtual world. This is another one that we've been working on, which is looking at collaboration. So bringing in individuals from across the world to create new products, so in terms of innovation. So this is a way, if you think about you want to develop a new product or new service that you'd like to launch in many different countries, it's very difficult to actually gain that market intelligence. Well, what do I know what they want, say, in Singapore or Canada? If I develop this product, I'd like to be able to launch it in many different, or a service. So here we're actually helping an entrepreneur who wanted to launch a website across the world. So we brought in, then, people from across the world through Second Life to our innovation workshop area. I can take you to it and show you afterwards. And we had different steps where we actually involved them, got them immersed in it. It's a running community. Got them immersed in being in a running environment, and then enabled them to actually have these collaboration environments. Now you can say, well, can't you just do this in physical life, right? You could just bring them together physically if you've wanted to. What you're seeing is that the ability, the creativity is released more in these virtual environments than actually in the physical environments. IBM and Schneider Electric, every year they have these get-togethers meetings where they bring people from IBM and people from Schneider. They put them in a room and say, okay, let's talk about what are we going to be doing for the next year or so. They've always done these physically. Well, this past year they decided, well, let's do it in Second Life. They found that the ideas that people were coming up with were much better and more ideas than they had in the physical environment. Because in the physical environment, you had very much people from IBM here, people from Schneider here, and you kind of get stuck in the way you think about, okay, you project onto a person, you already have these type of assumptions about who that individual is. But here, it's more of a playful environment, and it releases creativity more. And that's where there's also some research Sorry, that's somebody at my school. There's some research going on in the U.S. looking at creativity in these environments. How can we release creativity in these environments? And I have some slides here as well where we're already starting to look at that. It's very much about flow. How do you create flow? So this is what we were doing is at first you put them, immerse them in this running. So we created a script so the person actually puts on running shoes and runs and gets into the mode of running and through different environments. And then afterwards we had these breakout sessions that were moderated by, in this case I was moderating. So here we actually had people from Canada, the US, Slovenia, Austria, Holland, and so on in this virtual innovation environment. We brainstormed around some ideas using this table, which gave us questions. Then afterwards, we could go down and sat here, and people could actually, this is called a brain board, could then write up their ideas here and vote on the different ideas and so on that were developed. Yes, please.
When you're interacting in this,
yes.
This area,
yeah.
Are you talking by headset?
You can chat or you can talk. And it depends on individuals. Some individuals prefer to chat. Some don't like to be approached and use their voice. Others like very much to use voice. What I find is the ability to have both. It creates a much richer communication, I find, because some people may be chatting, some people may be speaking, but people can ask questions while others are, say, speaking. And you have the ability to actually record what's being said, both through voice or through the chat function. So it's both. Yeah. And that's actually all free as well. So then we had our brain board here, and so people were then voting and so on the different. What will happen when we can actually start creating things together? I mean, still, the user interface, we're not there yet, right? We still have this, mouse and these drop-down menus and so on. What will happen when actually we have the camera on us that sees we move our arm and our avatar automatically moves its arm? Or that we can start building things and things automatically happen. Actually, research is already, they've already developed a lot of these devices already. But we're not there yet in terms of bringing it out to the public. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. Yes, you are. Yeah, it's quite easy to learn. In fact, the students that you saw there, they had never been in World Before Friday. So within the 2 hours, they learned more or less everything to do that. And in the IBM teaming exercise as well, we gave them a tip sheet. It was a two-sides sheet with instructions on how to do simple things such as moving around. So it's quite easy. I can show you afterwards as well. So, and I can go in there too. Mm-hmm. So actually very easy for anybody to actually, I think, you get stuck this technology threshold. It's going to be so difficult. But actually you get in and it's quite very easy to maneuver and move around. It's quite self-explanatory. Please feel free to ask any questions that you'd like. Here is one example, Ernst & Young. This is from Tony O'Driscoll's book. He said that, Ernst & Young hires all these MBAs, right? And then they put them into this training course. And it's about 130, hours the first year that they have to train if they want to do an inventory observation. So see, these are, going out into the field, going into factories and so on and doing inventory count. And usually they would sit at their desk doing this, right? And they said, well, why can't we create an environment where they can actually go in and experience what it might be like to actually be doing a real inventory observation? So they created this grandmother's chocolate chip cookie factory. And so they have to go in, and they have the learning. First, in the beginning, they get an overview of what they can do and what they need to learn about to be prepared for this inventory observation. And then they go out and actually have to do certain tasks. And you have, actually, you can either have role play, for example. In this case, they actually have bots, so they've pre-programmed avatars to actually in there to answer questions and so on. But they're presented with challenges, right? You get a problem, which is very difficult to actually do if you're doing the traditional learning, if you're sitting at a desk. Okay, you stumble over a problem. You think you come up with an answer, but it's quite different when you're actually there doing it. So here, this person is, I have to get way up there. I have to find something and count something way up there. How do I do that? Okay, well, I need to find somebody with one of these pitchforks. I have to go and find that person. Or, look, the labels are missing. What do I do now? So you actually create this environment within which this person can maneuver around and experience what it's like to actually do an inventory observation. What they found in terms of benefits and results, they learned and retained as much as their ILs, so the ones who are actually doing the physical world training. The cost and time requirements was less than ILT, quite a bit less for this, doing this. But interesting, this was an interesting result. The people who did this in 3D, they felt less confident at the end of the training than those who had done it in the physical world. Is that a good thing or a bad thing to be less confident? It's actually, I found, it's a very good thing because that means that you're not so, I know this is the way it's to be done. I'm so sure about it. Yeah, go ahead. This is in Second Life, yeah. So actually, I think most of the examples that he uses in his book actually are all from Second Life. And that's what you're seeing is most actually are being done in Second Life just because they provide the opportunity to actually create your own content. For example, in Entropy Universe that I talked about, it's very difficult to create your own content to the same degree. Many of the other worlds have not gotten that far. And I mentioned this program in the U.S. from the National Science Foundation. All the proposals that I read that discuss doing research in virtual worlds, the only world that they mentioned was Second Life, interestingly. So we'll see if they're still around in 5 years or who knows, but still, most of them, this is done in Second Life. So this is just one example. Here are some other examples. Medical training by Forterra. Unfortunately, Forterra it looks like it's going, they downsized quite dramatically because of the recession, 60 people after it last year, and they're looking to be sold, so we'll see. Virtual collaboration by Proton Media, workshop training by Teleplace from Quack. So these are other worlds. You do have, you know, you were asking about most in Second Life. There are other worlds out there which are proprietary that you can use. I don't know in terms of pricing how these play out. Second Life seems to be quite cheap, and I can say you can actually find a lot of people who want to build things for free and do things for free. So if you can use students, you can just post an ad and say, does anybody want to build, you know, an environment for me? People love to do it because they get to put it on their resume and they have fun. So it's amazing. You should try never to pay any for anything out there because you really can get a lot very cheap. I mean, it's amazing. People love to be involved. So building the business case, you say, yeah, 10 minutes. Building the business case, right? So here are some examples. Very much here from Microsoft, for example, said, wow, you know, if we could use this. They actually did not use Second Life. They created their own Global Inclusion Summit. They made a tremendous amount of savings by using this virtual world, bringing together people virtually to meet. Mercedes-Benz simulated the manufacture of an aluminum component. IBM held virtual conference and annual meeting, savings of $250,000. And so on. Canadian Border Patrol, this wasn't interesting. They had training courses in World. And they found that when they actually did the training course in World, the grades increased by 37% over those who had done the same training in the physical world. So here are just some examples of, yes, we're beginning to see that the results really are worth the effort. If you want to create a successful virtual learning environment, I have a few slides here in terms of how we went about developing our environment. This comes very much from the customer, it was the marketing literature, how can you build a virtual customer environment? And they talk about four different levers that you'd like to see. Pragmatic, so there's this experience of you're actually achieving the learning objectives. What we've done is we've taken these and adapted them to learning. Sociability, you have the perception of being a member of a group or community. You have usability, so the quality that you can, it's very easy to use, the nice interface. You have the quality of human-computer interactions. Hedonic, meaning feeling of being mentally stimulated or entertained. This is what we followed when we developed and designed our innovation workshop as well as our teaming. How can we do this? And what we've seen is that doing this, you get into the state of flow. How many of you have heard of flow? It's used quite a lot within, say, the IS, the information science and so on field. How do you get this feeling where you kind of check out of everything around that is around you and you're so focused on what you're doing? You become very much in the flow, as you say. And we found this. We've done quite a bit of research on our innovation workshop and our teaming experience. I've seen very much that these, yes, characteristics do lead to people entering the state of flow. I have some tips here, which you can all, you know, get through the PowerPoint that's online. But I talk about, you know, the initial design and the design, what to think through the different steps if you're actually interested in building and trying to do something in these virtual worlds. So I think here is ensure the learning objectives drive the design, not the technology. The technology should play second role. I think, yes, what's really important is think freely. Don't be restricted by the real world. But keep it simple. Try not to overdo it. I mean, this teaming example that we have, it's a very simple exercise, really, is to build a bridge. Yeah, it was very powerful in terms of the learnings that the people got from the exercise. Yes, you had a question.
I think about this freedom of thought.
Yes.
Being restricted by the real world.
Yeah.
I'm wondering why then there's so much evidence of very pronounced things like walls and chairs and tables,
yeah.
People sitting in groups being separated,
yes.
And flip charts,
yeah. Yeah, I think it's fascinating. Well, I think we have to have something that we can hold on to. If everything is different, if everything is new, then how will we know how to relate? I think it creates too much change. So I think in some ways it's nice to have something that we can refer to and relate to. So maybe it's a chair, or actually I've seen people are starting to do where you just sit on the ground, or you don't even sit at all, but you need something that still kind of anchors you. I think we're not quite there yet. So I think that's you see people build buildings with roofs and small doors, you can't get in, and you know, why? So I think this is where we get very stuck in our real world thinking. So this is initial design and design. Preparation, this is very important in terms of really seeing getting a good result. And I think this is where don't assume that this younger generation is tech savvy. I mean, for example, my master's students, some of them are, you know, young 20s, and yet still they've never been in Second Life. They don't know about these. So I think this is where they don't know how to, say, install it on their computer and so on. But I think this is very important to really work a lot in terms of thinking about what are the contingencies, what might go wrong, and having a lot of facilitators on hand. Running the event, for example, adequate time for setup. What you find is you say, let's start an event at this time. Well, it never starts at that time because people get in world. You know, they can't get their voice to work. They don't know how to move around yet. So you still have to spend some time actually working with them on doing that. We say very much ensure adequate debriefing. It's important. Let's reflect on what we've done here. What went well? What didn't go well? What did you learn? And so on. And we often conduct follow-up surveys, learning about how did the participants experience this? How did it affect them afterwards, and so on? So, what are the challenges going forward? I just see this as in terms of virtual worlds and learning and so on. Very much, what are the skills and roles required? I mean, the skills of teachers is changing tremendously. For at our university, I try to get more involved, and some of them are still using overheads. So I think this is where, it's many different skills and, roles are required within this. And how do you get over from being the talking head and being somebody who's a facilitator? What does content look like? And again, is creation for real world for in-world or in-world for real world? I mean, this, you can go different ways. Created by the program or the participants? Remember I was talking about co-creation. And how do we escape our real world thinking? And how is this whole process best facilitated? How can we incorporate this, into a larger learning program? So how do we ensure this seamlessness? Those are just some challenges. I think this is the way, I like the way that Kappen O'Driscoll kind of talked about, this is where we get so stuck over here. We think about the exploitation-exploration continuum. So in other words, this is where you're doing, this is your exploring, right? This is where you're exploiting everything that you've already done. Learning and much of what we do is very much this productive learning. We're just getting better at what we already know how to do. But how do we really then go beyond this and do generative learning, where we're starting to explore and create new tasks, new ideas, as opposed to learning already roles that are previously determined? I think that's the exciting challenge, and that's where we really can use virtual worlds to leverage that. So this was, in case anybody's interested more, I've referred to some of his book, Tony O'Driscoll. There he is with his avatar. There's his book. So if anybody's interested, get it on Amazon. Here's some other Second Life sources in case you're interested as well. I can say this SLED list is really good if you're interested in just looking at education, what's going on in Second Life. It's a very active mailing list. Search the archives if you're interested, but there's so much out there. People are very helpful. I put this up as think about where were we in 1996? That wasn't that long ago, was it? This is the Norwegian newspaper, DN. And business newspapers says, internet's a flop, right? None of the actors on the net will ever earn any money. Who would ever use it in their private life? And not only that, there'll be so much information out there. How would we ever find it? Well, we've seen quite a different story now. I couldn't imagine not living with the internet. So with that, I'd like to say thank you. There's me and my avatar. You know where to find me. You can feel free to send me an email at any time or contact me in world and so on. We have this island, Stockholm School of Economics Island, so if anybody's interested in, doing a presentation just to try it out, if you'd like to run an exercise, let me know. I have a master's student from China who really wants to do a new innovation workshop, and we're looking for a company or an organization that would be interested in doing that. So I have lots of master's students who come and want to do things. And I have this research project. So, feel free to reach out and ask questions and see if you want to participate. So I think, questions. Yeah.